with my love and respects. Today's subject is drop your mind, find your center. Let's enter into the today's sutra, then we will see what Shiva says in that sutra and why he is telling us to drop our mind. What's the reason? Daman Dakshobha Sambuddha सूक्ष्म अग्नि तिलकाकृतम् बिंदुं शिकान्ते हृदये लयान्ते ध्यायतो लयः. वेरी ब्यूटिफुल श्लोक. संस्कृत इज नॉट ओनली इंपॉर्टेंट लिंग्विस्टिकली, इट इज इंपॉर्टेंट फोनेटिकली आल्सो. The very sound, the very vibration created by that mantras does something to your being, does something to you. Let me repeat the sutra, Shiva's words, then we will enter into the meaning. What Shiva means by saying the word drop your mind. दमान तक्षोभा संबुद्ध सूक्ष्माग्नितिलकाकृतिं बिंदुं शिकान्ते हृदये लयान्ते ध्यायतो लयः. लेट मी गिव यू अ ट्रांसलेशन. टू टेल यू ऑनेस्टली, द ट्रांसलेशन इज नॉट expressing the whole thing which is expressed in mantra in the Sanskrit original words, but this is the translation as are now available. To tell you honestly, even if I translate, I can't do anything more than that, because the Sanskrit is, that language is so profound. It is specially created to express the inexpressible, to express the truth which can't be expressed by words. So it's very poetic. What Shiva means by the sutra, I'll try to explain through this whole discourse, but what literally, what best we can do the literal translation, I'll try to give you the literal translation. Literal translation says, when on a bed or a seat, asana, asana means comfortably, sthiram, sukham, itam, asanam, in Sanskrit we say, which is comfortable and steady for your body, which does not need your attention, which does not need your awareness. In some position, when you are in some position, if your body doesn't ask your attention, means if your body doesn't hurt you, means you are in right position, you are in right asana. When on a bed or on a seat, let yourself become weightless beyond mind. Beautiful. Such a simple, wonderful technique to go beyond mind. Shiva is actually teaching how to make your whole life into meditation, how to constantly jump into the space of no mind, how to constantly jump into the space of eternal consciousness, how to jump into the peace in which is in your being through all possible methods. If you are talking to somebody, he teaches you how to talk so that you can enter into meditation. If you are listening to somebody, he teaches you how to listen so that you can enter into meditation. if you are eating, he is teaching you how to eat so that you can enter into meditation. If you are drinking something, he teaches you how to drink. He is practically giving you techniques to enter into meditation using all things which you do in your life. Actually, you cannot become enlightened just by one or two simple things. You can become enlightened just by one or two simple things if you are really intense. But if you are intense, then you don't need enlightenment. You are already enlightened. You are here because you are not complete, you are not intense. So naturally, just one or two things won't help. Shiva is here to open all possible doors. He is pushing you into that source, into your being, into that bliss through all possible doors. He is the first and last master who opened all the doors. There are so many masters who opened one door, two, maximum 10. Shiva is the master, first and last, because still nobody else has done that job. He is opening all the doors, all possible doors are opened by him in this single book. According to me, this book is the unabridged dictionary of all spiritual philosophies. All spiritual philosophies are recorded, I can say, created, expressed through this book in an unabridged way, in its fullest form. He says, when on a bed or a seat, let yourself become weightless beyond mind. If you see Shiva sitting, he is sitting in the same way only. How he says he is sitting in the same way. That's why I always tell people, Shiva is Shiva Sutra. He is expressing his own being. You can't separate Shiva and Shiva Sutra. You can't separate master and experience. When you try to have some part of Shiva or benefits, only benefits from Shiva, without accepting his wholeness, his whole being, then you are in trouble. Somebody asked me in Los Angeles, Swamiji, Shiva is represented by phallic symbol, means sex organ in India. In India, if you go to any temple, there won't be any temple in India which doesn't have that Shivalinga. It's a sex organ. How can you worship Shiva in this form? What is this? Please be very clear. It is not just sex organ. It is the representation of creativity, energy from where we are all born. The energy from where we all have come out. It is the representation of our father and mother energy, the universal father and mother energy from where we all have come out, from whom we all have originated. The linga represents the universal father, cosmic father. The yoni represents the cosmic mother, universal mother. Through this form, we are representing the cosmic mother and cosmic father. And one more thing, unless you accept the root energy, the base energy which is in you, you can't transform it. You can't transform it. People use only few benefits which they get from master, do not understand or try to realize the whole of the master. God is only just utility for us. Like a pickle, whenever you want, you just touch it. When you don't want, you just push it aside. Small story. Guy met with an accident, taken to Mercy Hospital in emergency room, after treatment, after 2 days, he is slowly regaining from coma. He is coming back to consciousness. Doctor and nurse, both of them are standing near him. Both of them were giving confidence to him. They are saying, "Don't worry, you are all right. You will become all right within few days." Nurse asked, "Are you covered by insurance?" He said, "No." "Then will you pay in cash?" He said, "I am afraid I may not be able to." She asked, "Do you have any relatives?" "No, I have only one sister. She is also become nun in New York. She is real spinster." Nurse was really offended. She said, "Don't talk. Sir, I want you to understand, nuns are not spinsters. They are married to God." He said, "Oh, in that case, send my bell to my brother-in-law." "In that case, send the bill to my brother-in-law." Be very clear. God cannot be just a utility. We are all trying to use God as just an utility. We are all trying to use the Master's utility. As long as he does and says things which we can understand and agree according to our frame, things are really beautiful. Okay. But when he does something which we don't understand, which is beyond our understanding, we are not able to understand. And we start criticizing. We start opposing. Of course, we are the one who are losers. Anyhow, now, if you see this Shiva statue, is exactly expressing the sutra which he is speaking. Of course, you don't have to see the statue. Even if you are not able to see, it's okay. He is just sitting straight. The same way in which he is explaining. And he is represented by a sex organ, Shivalinga. Why he is represented by that organ, and why he is sitting and meditating, what he wants to say through the sutra, and how all these three things are connected is the whole discourse. Sutra says, when on a bed or a seat, let yourself become weightless beyond mind. Shiva says, becoming weightless will take you beyond mind. Let me tell you about an experiment about which I read. Around the world, this experiment is going on. Still, doctors are trying to weigh the body of the man before death and after death. Constantly they are trying to weigh, because the East is claiming that a soul leaves the body. All the Eastern masters are claiming soul leaves the body when a person dies. They just want some proof. If something leaves the body, then naturally it should become weightless. Some weight should reduce, because according to science, everything has got weight. The big problem is science has entered into the realm of only matter. Only in matter level, everything has got weight. Now they have even measured sun rays, the weight of sun rays. They say 10 square miles. The sun rays which falls on 10 square miles, if you weigh them, it comes to the weight of one hair. Now they are able to weigh even the sun rays. They have proved everything has got weight. So now the only thing which they are trying to do, they are trying to weigh a body before death and after death, so that if there is a weight difference, if there is a less weight, then they can understand the weight of the soul. they are trying their best all over the world, the research is going on. But not only weight is not reducing, suddenly the weight is increasing. See, when a soul leaves the body, not only weight is not reducing, but weight is only increasing. Now doctors are in a big confusion. Because as far as they know, everything has got weight. And all these masters and mystics are constantly repeating, soul leaves the body when you die. Then there must be weight difference. Your weight should become little less when you are alive and after your death. But instead of weight reducing, your body is gaining the weight. What's going on? They are not able to understand. You need to understand an important secret. This is the key of this whole sutra. Your presence is weightlessness. Your presence is weightlessness. Whenever you are present inside your body, you are weightless. That is why when you leave the body, it becomes more heavy. When you leave the body, it becomes more heavy. One more thing. Whenever you feel your body is heavy, that part of that body is losing your presence. If you have knee pain, you have not given your presence to the knees. That is why that portion is heavy. If you are feeling heavy in the stomach, you have not given your presence to stomach. That's why that part feels heavy. In every part, you feel heavy when you don't give your presence to that part. That is why when your presence leaves your body gains weight. Means your presence is weightlessness. By the very nature, your presence is weightlessness. When the weightlessness leaves your body becomes heavy. Not only with human beings, even with animals, they are experimenting. They are experimenting even with animals. The moment the animal dies, the body becomes heavy. One more thing, and this is the amazing thing. Even before chemical change starts happening, you may say because of some chemical changes, the fluids may become solid. That may be the reason why the weight is increasing. Doctors are saying, even before the chemical changes starts happening, the moment the person is dead, immediately, because the chemical changes, it takes at least 3-4 hours. Even before the chemical changes starts happening, the weight is increasing. Still, they are not able to find the mystery behind this research. They are yet to catch up with the spirituality. They are yet to catch up with the spirituality. Thousands of years ago, Shiva says, your presence is weightlessness. Now, with so much of research, they are proving the same thing. They are proving the same thing, but the problem is they are not able to clearly create a formula, technology out of this truth. Shiva has not only said the truth, he has created a beautiful technology, practical way to use this truth. He has created applied science also. Actually, all scientific discoveries, when they are doing, the person who discovers, the scientist himself, is not aware of the utility or the practical application of the research or what he has discovered. Later on, they start using it, applying it in the life. Only then the person who invented suddenly realizes, oh God, there are so many ways this truth is getting used. Even Einstein was shocked when some scientist declared his theory has got practical value. In some of his letters, he writes, I never thought it has got some practical value. I always thought it has got only theoretical value. like a big bang theories. There are so many theories. Just yesterday I read a beautiful article. They say that now they are coming up with more and more evidence in NASA to prove in less than a microsecond, from subatomic level to macrocosmic level, the whole universe has happened. The whole universe happened from subatomic level to the macrocosmic level, to the whole universal level, in less than microsecond. They are describing in a very detailed way what Taittiriya Upanishad, one of the beautiful Upanishad, it says, Atmana Akasha, from Atman, Akasha just appeared, Akasha Vayuhu, Vayor Agnihi, Agnir Apaha, Apa Prithvihi, Prithivyor Annam. He says in Taittiriya Upanishad, the great seer, Rishi says, a great saint, he says, just like that, without any gap in time or in space, simply the space exploded from consciousness. From the space came the air. From the air came Agni, fire. From fire came water. From water came earth. From earth came the life, or the source of life, the seed of life. Vedas always believed, and they are always telling the universe happened just like that. They say just like that it happened, it expressed, it exploded. Now the NASA is saying the same thing. They say less than microsecond. I don't know how you will measure less than microsecond, but they say less than microsecond only it took for, from subatomic level to the macrocosmic, universal level, just like that it happened. Anyhow, whatever the scientists are trying to prove, not only the truth, the application of the truth, both are presented by these great masters. Shiva says, your presence is weightlessness. Your presence is weightlessness. Let you be very clear. This is an important key to understand this whole sutra. Daman dakshobha sambukta sukshmagni tilakakritim bindum shikante hrutaye layante dhyayato layaha. Layante means non-existence or weightlessness. Even weightlessness is not a right word, because I don't have any other word, I am using that word. Please understand the truth which I am expressing, which I am explaining. That will give you an idea. Beautiful sutra. Layante dhyayato layaha. He says, become weightless and enter into the laya, means beyond the mind, the weightless space itself. Let you become weightless and enter the space beyond mind. The key is, your presence is weightlessness. You can see in your life, if you are feeling heaviness in some part of the body, you have not given your presence to that part of the body. You have not attended that part of the body. If you have a knee pain or stomach pain, just put your awareness on that area for 10 minutes. Simply you will see the pain will disappear. I tell you, because not only I practiced, there are so many of our devotees, disciples who are doctors, medical doctors have practiced this technique. And they say it really works, Swamiji. All you need to do is, where you have pain, just put your awareness in that area. Do not remember the word pain, just drop that word and look what is happening in that area. Just see what is happening in that area. Just relax. Just give your presence. And you will see, simply experience the weightlessness. Not only with your body, even with other persons, even in the outer world, if you are feeling heavy with somebody, give your attention, the weight will disappear. You will carry your heaviness as long as you don't have courage to give your attention to that person, as long as you don't have courage to open with that person. If you can open up and drop the heaviness, you will see even your relationship becomes weightless. You will not have weight in your head. All your ego is nothing but you not giving your presence, you not giving your awareness to that part of you. Wherever it hurts, whether it is physical, mental, in relationship wise, give your awareness, give your presence. Immediately, that hurting will disappear. Because your presence by its own nature heals. Your presence, your very presence has got the power to heal. People ask me, Swamiji, for your meditation techniques, for your healing, your presence is necessary. I tell them, my presence is not necessary, your presence is enough. For my healing to work, for my meditations to work, my presence is not necessary, your presence is enough. But you need to give your presence. You forgot how to be present. That is why you are depending on my presence. If you can be present, you don't need my presence. You don't need my presence. You are caught with so many things. You are caught in so many things. Even if you are present physically, never ever think you are present here. You can see in your life, morning when you get up and brush your teeth, already your mind is in the office, thinking and planning. When you are sitting in the office, already you are in the house, trying to clean and do something. When you are in the house, already you are in the temple or beach or in the discourse, thinking what you are supposed to do going there and what you should do, what you are supposed to do and what you are not supposed to do, with whom you want to fight, with whom you want to relate, and what you want to do, what you plan, everything. When you are in the lecture, already you are sitting here and thinking when to go back to the house. I don't know when he will finish the lecture, and I don't know when the energy session will be over. I don't know how long it is going to take. I think in the gap itself, I will go away. I have to go. It is getting too late nowadays. The energization is ending only in 11 o'clock. You are sitting and planning. Be very clear. If you are here, you are not here. That one thing is sure. If you are here, you are not here. You forgot how to be present. You forgot how to be simple. You forgot how to be relaxed. You forgot how to be. That is why you are constantly dependent on my presence. If you can relax into your presence, you don't need my presence. Shiva says, your presence is weightlessness. Layante means nothingness, disappearing. By your very presence, you are weightlessness. For example, feel how a cow is lying and he is there, he is eating, he is swallowing, he is drinking, but there is no being inside. He has got life, but there is no individuality, there is no personality. For your body to carry its regular things, for your body to live on this planet Earth, you don't need personality, you don't need individuality. Your body can be alive on this planet Earth without personality. Let it be very clear. Constantly you are frightened, threatened by society unless you carry your identities. Unless you hold on to your identities, you cannot protect yourself. But it is your identity which creates all physical and mental sickness. When somebody gives you torture, when somebody gives you suffering, you feel sick of them. But one thing which gives you constant suffering, which nags you whole day, you don't feel sick of that. That's your identity. Constantly you are being nagged, beaten, tortured, but you don't feel sick of it. Because society has taught you, without it, you can't live. Without it, you can't live. I tell you, without it, you will live in a much more beautiful way, in a much more wonderful way. Whenever it is necessary, automatically your biointelligence will awaken. Even if you have to fight, automatically your being will fight. Whatever has to happen, those words will come out, that body language will express, and you will relax. You will not be bothered. You will not carry that constant irritation. I have always seen people who do rehearsal to fight, when they are on the spot, they will not be able to fight because all the arguments which they prepared will not come to their memory. They would have prepared all the arguments. I have always seen these wives or husbands, after the fight is over, when they are sitting in the sofa in a different rooms, that time all the arguments which you thought you should, which did not come to the memory, will come back. Yeah. See, Dubey is telling, yeah. Whatever arguments which would have helped you to win, or you think would have helped you to win, which did not come at that time, will be coming in when you are sitting alone. And you will be ready with all these arguments. When he comes back from the office, you will start again. And suddenly, again you will see, after 2-3 statements, you forget the big project work which you prepared. Or the big file which you prepared. It's not there again. And you wait. Again, that night you will be sitting and doing your homework, remembering everything. And next day morning when you start again, you will miss. Person who fights with individuality, means having an individuality and fighting, even fighting you won't be able to do properly. Let you be clear. You always think with individuality you can protect yourself. You can't. Because with individuality, constantly you are dependent on your past experience. You are preparing arguments. If he says this way, I will tell this way. If he talks this way, I will talk this way. If he comes this way, I'll come this way. You are ready with some 10-12 type of arguments. And one important thing, present is never going to be like a past. Even if he comes with the same argument, sometimes just because of your pressure or tension, you will not have exact counter argument. After fighting, after 1 hour, suddenly you will remember, "Arre, this is what I thought, now I forgot." You will be sitting and repenting. I think all of you will be able to relate with the example what I am saying. All of you would have gone through the same. Let it be very clear. Even in your life, you cannot protect you if you carry the identity, if you carry individuality, if you carry personality, because it is completely related to past. Is nowhere related to present. It's nothing to do with present. It is nothing to do with spontaneity. Whenever I remember a word spontaneous, I have a beautiful story. At least I think I would have told this story 100 times, but I never miss a chance to tell this story. Because it is such a beautiful story, how the person who is not cultured through education or so-called civilization, how they have sharp spontaneity. You can always see person who has not gone through the so-called culture or so-called civilization, so-called education, so-called trainings, he will be more spontaneous and alive. He can handle things in a much more straight way. Because all social training is nothing but training to prepare yourself before entering into the situation. Forget about fights. Even when you go to meet your friend in the car itself, you will be preparing all the dialogues. All the dialogue. You can't even meet your friend spontaneously. Even if you go to meet your friend, you are not dependent on your spontaneity. You do not trust your spontaneity. You do not trust your weightlessness. You are preparing the file. You are preparing the file. What should I tell? It's because you have to impress him or impress her. The game of impressing is going on. Even with your friend, you cannot relax. That is why, actually, dialogue never happens. I can say, at least after the age of 6 or 7, dialogue never happens in your life. You listen to the other person so that now you can start shouting. Actually, you listen to the other person, you are not even listening, you are preparing your argument in that gap time. So, by that time, you start putting all your things and he starts preparing his argument. The listening never happens. Listening never happens. Just each one is preparing and doing only the catharsis. Actually, analysts are paid just to listen. You don't have anybody to listen in the modern day. What will you do? There is nobody to listen. You start talking to your wife, she says, keep your problems with you, I have enough. If you start talking to your husband, he says, enough, relax, I have enough. And he starts telling his stories. That is why you need a psychoanalyst. He listens to your story, he gets paid just to listen to your stories. Nothing else. Really, the modern days, the person goes to psychoanalyst and you are made to lie down on the couch and they put the screen also. Freudians, they put screen because the emotional attachment should not happen. Only then you will be very objective. So, they put the screen between the patient and the doctor. And sometimes you don't even know whether the doctor is sitting other side or not. It seems it happened once, doctor prepared a audio cassette saying, more, next, what happened, what's going on, yes, right, just these words. He prepared audio cassettes, whenever patient comes, he'll make them lie down on that couch, put the screen, switch on the tape, go away. One day, by mistake, even before the patient finished the statement, the audio system started telling, yes, go ahead. Then the patient had a little doubt. What is happening? He just moved the screen and saw the other side tape recorder is sitting. And next day onwards, he started bringing his own recorded version. Moment doctor goes away, he puts his cassette and goes away. That's all. Two tape recorders are sitting and listening to each other. When doctor can keep a cassette, why not me? He records in the house itself, whatever he wants to say. He brings the cassette, puts the cassette, and the moment doctor moves out of his cabin, he also puts the cassette and goes away. It is nothing but two tape recorders listening to each other. Actually, man has become never so poor in the whole civilization like 21st century. In 21st century, he doesn't have even people to listen to him. Forget about healing him. He doesn't have people even to listen to him. Over. He is completely out. I don't know what is in store or what is next. I think nothing more can happen. Nothing more can happen. One thing we can all be sure, nothing worse can happen now. Everything has been done. Nothing more can be done. Nothing more needs to be done also. Nothing more needs to be done. Anyhow, Shiva says, by your very nature, you are weightless, spontaneous. If you are feeling, one important technique, if you want to find out whether you are egoistic or not, if you are constantly having a heaviness around this area, if you are constantly remembering your head, be very clear, you have tremendous ego. If you are aware of your head, let you be very clear, you have ego. You may say, sometimes I don't feel aware, I am not aware of my head at all, Swamiji. When you laugh loudly, when you are dancing, when you are sitting with somebody with whom you feel connected, your beloved, rarely with your husband, or rarely with with father or with mother, when you are really opened yourself, when you are really opened yourself, at those few moments you will really, you won't feel the boundary of your head. You won't feel you have a head. You will feel the weightlessness. Those moments really you are experiencing meditation. Those moments you are having the glimpse of meditation. When you are loudly laughing or dancing, not to show to anybody, or not as a professional dancer, just jumping for no reason. See these kids whirling? They don't whirl so that somebody will pay up for them. They don't whirl after that they can collect a ticket. No. Just jump. Just whirling. Just out of joy. Just out of celebrating. Just because 4 or 5 are there and you can see each other in joy. And you can just see the other smiles, and just you are sharing the smiles. Just you are inspired by the smiles. When you jump around, same way, when you paint, just inspired by smiles. When somebody sees and he enjoys, if you are inspired just by that smile and do something, you will feel the boundarylessness in the head. You will be spontaneous. As long as you are aware or you have a boundary, you are pressured, you can't be creative, you can't be artistic. There is a beautiful story, Zen story. Disciple, great painter, was asked by the master to paint the master. Master is sitting. Disciple is painting. Whole day he painted, finished the painting. When he showed the painting to the master, master first thing he did, give a big blow. Simply kicked him. In Zen masters are not so-called cultured or polished. They were straight away work. They don't talk much. They don't waste time in talking. The disciple was shocked. What is this? What have I done? He said, fool, don't paint you, paint me. Don't paint you, paint me. When you do it with your ego, you will paint you. Your idea about me, how you look at me, not me. Disciple was not able to understand. Every day, 5 to 6 hours, disciple sits with master and paints. Finally, he gets just to get the beating. And it goes on and on and on for 10 days. Finally, that day, actually, master is working on the disciple. He is teaching him how to paint egolessly. How to paint without personality, without individuality. Creating after enough of pressure, now the moment disciple sees the master, he starts shivering. He has started shivering. In those days, disciples used to be afraid of master. Once upon a time, disciples used to be afraid of master. Anyhow, finally, the last day, when disciple was painting, suddenly master says, I wanted to go to bathroom, you continue your painting. He went away. When he came back, he saw the disciple was painting without his being. He accepted that painting. Not only that, he says, now you understood how to paint without being. You may think how it happened. The moment master moved, the pressure on the disciple's head has disappeared. The pressure, he is being watched. The pressure he has to satisfy has disappeared. The moment that has disappeared, he was able to do it in a beautiful way without the being, without the personality. Before he started painting, in his head there was so many pressure to satisfy this person, this and that. So many weights were there on his head. When he started working with the master, by creating big pressure, he removed all other pressures. Actually, if you get married, you won't have any other suffering. That one suffering is enough to take away. And this reflexology, if you go through reflexology, you will not have any other pain, because that pain is that pain is enough to take away all other pains. Same way, sometimes big pains takes away all the small pains. Master sits on him and takes away all other weights. And after removing all other weights, he removes himself. And suddenly disciple feels the weightlessness and enters into the spontaneous energy. And he became a great painter. Let me tell you this story which I was about to tell about the spontaneity. If you know the great epic Mahabharata, it is the history of India. If you read that book, you will be able to understand this story, because this related to that book. In that book, there is a story, there is a scene. The queen Draupadi, will be disrobed, will be abused by villain's brother. Villain's brother is Duryodhana. We call it Duryodhana. His name is Duryodhana. He will be disrobing, abusing her in common palace, in the common darbar, in the court. He will be abusing her. She is a great devotee of Krishna. Krishna is incarnation of God. When she calls Krishna, when she was being abused, she calls Krishna. Immediately Krishna appears and protects her, supplies cloth, abundant clothes. And this Duryodhana, the villain, was not able to remove all the clothes. He is completely tired, he drops dead. This is the story. According to story, the villain will be disrobing the queen. She will pray to God, and God will appear in the scene and give her enough of clothes. He will be just pulling the cloth will be coming, and It is just like a hill made out of clothes. So much of clothes will come out of our body. Then this fellow automatically drops dead. This is the scene. In India, the beauty is every village will have the recitation of Mahabharata. Means reciting this story is a ritual done in every village. At least once a year, they will do this ritualistic recitation of the story. And no mic or anything. Just they will get into the stage and start singing or shouting. It will be really fun to watch the whole thing. And usually the kids and the old ladies who don't have any other work, they will come and sit there. And they will chew the tobacco leaf and spit on somebody and spit the juice on somebody. You will have a little prasad and tirtha. And all these kids will do 1, 2, 3, everything there itself. Nothing can be done. And it will all be there. You will be sitting amidst of all these things and enjoying the drama. And it's like a village gathers together. And not only Mahabharata, all the village stories also will be told there. Each one will be talking to others about what happened to her and what happened to him, who ran away with whom, who is living with whom and who is doing what. The whole story, they will share there only. It's like a common place, get together, where they will sit and speak all these things. And traditionally, women are not allowed to participate, women are not allowed to act in the drama. Female role also will be played by male only. Male only will play the female role also. Now you have to understand the whole scene, only then you can enjoy the spontaneity. Only then you can enjoy the spontaneity or the whole thing, what is how things happen. And there will not be much instruments or materials. If the there will be only one stick with a big tin attached to it. If Saraswati holds that stick like that, you have to think it is a veena. If Anuman holds like that, you have to think it is a gadayuda. The same stick will become veena and gadayuda. You can't do anything about it. And the same stick will be used for everything. Gadayuda means weapon, veena means musical instrument. For both, they will bring the same stick only. That will only be used for all the purposes. It's like a multi-purpose. And sometimes same actor will come playing 2-3 roles. And he will just change only one cloth, one shawl. And he will come back and tell the story. Anyhow, that day part is that Draupadi, means the queen, is supposed to come with a 7 sari tied on one on the other. So that the Duchadana will pull the saris. By the time it comes to 6th sari, the queen has to shout Krishna, Krishna. The Krishna will jump from behind the stage and he will jump into the stage and say, "Oh, my dear devotee, I have come to protect you. You are protected." Immediately the villain has to act as if he is tired and he will drop dead. This is the story. By mistake, the villain forgot the count that day. Instead of pulling only the 6th sari, till the 6th sari, he started pulling the 7th sari also. The queen is wearing 7 saris. The villain is supposed to stop at the 6th sari. And till 6th sari, the queen will not call Krishna. She will be telling something Madhava, Madhusudana, Keshava, some other names. Only when this comes to the 6th sari, only when the villain is little tired or acts as if he is tired, she will call Krishna. Then Krishna will jump from the stage, from behind the stage. He is standing behind, smoking beedi actually. I am telling you the whole scene, what is going on there. And Krishna is standing with his mukuta and flute in one hand. Flute means the same stick. And he is just enjoying the smoking the bidi. Bidi means the village cigarette. And he is enjoying the bidi, waiting for call. And this villain forgot the number count. And he is pulling the 7th sari also. And suddenly Draupadi realized the seventh saree is being pulled. And because the seventh saree is being pulled, instead of calling Krishna, straight away she started kicking Duryodhana, Duchadana. She started kicking the villain. Hey, leave me, da. Hey, leave me. According to the, we were all surprised. What is going on? Usually the fight is not supposed to happen. How can queen fighting with villain? It doesn't. She is supposed to call Krishna, Krishna. Instead of that, she is straight away attacking the villain. And the fight has started. And this villain guy also did not understand what is going on, or yes, he is doing some mistake. Somehow, finally, in that mess, whole mess, he pulled the seventh saree. Now, she is standing with a trouser. On the stage, in a public stage, above the hip, female decoration, female makeup, with all the female dress and female jewelries, hair and the flower, everything is female. With all the traditional turmeric powder and decoration. And below with a trouser, he is standing. On the main stage. Behind that, Krishna is looking through the screen, still why I am not called, with a beedi. With a beedi, he is standing and looking through the screen. Why still I am not called? What is going on there? What is going on? And the whole villages are laughing. Because the whole thing is now messed up. She is supposed to be women. Actually, male only act the role of female also. Now he is standing half male and half female. And Duchadana suddenly realized the mistake. Seventh saree has been pulled. Now he has to drop dead. He can't drop dead also unless Krishna comes. Unless Krishna comes, he can't drop dead. Now the whole scene is confusion. Now what to do? But the spontaneity of this Draupadi, suddenly she said, Krishna, just because you cannot come, you made me into male, you converted me into male and saved my shame, saved my prestige. Oh Krishna, you are so powerful. Just because you could not appear on the stage in proper time, you are busy with your beedi, you made me male and saved my prestige. You see, the statement itself is not a big thing, but spontaneity. In that situation, if you get angry, you can't do anything. If you are taken away by shame, you can't do anything. You can't do anything. You can't do patch up. All you need is spontaneity. If you understand how these dramas are done in India, you'll be able to enjoy. You'll be able to, if you can remember the scenes, you'll be able to enjoy. The whole thing, just by single statement, she has made the whole thing straight. And the whole village has now started laughing at her statement. They forgot that there is some serious mistake done in the drama. The idea that there is something wrong happened in the drama has disappeared from everybody's mind. Now everybody is involved with only that fun. The whole atmosphere has changed just by one statement. This can happen only when you are spontaneous, not when you carry identity. When you carry identity or personality, you will only be fighting or trying to pick up that saree and tie yourself. And how will you cover? Because everything is open now. After that, what will you cover? And nothing can be done. The behind the Krishna is standing with the beedi and slowly looking through that screen. And the smoke is also coming through that screen. Smoke is also coming through that screen. Only through spontaneity, this kind of situations can be handled. In life also, you can't live your life completely with your prepared dialogues. With your prepared dialogues. You can't live your whole life with your dialogues. Do not write the story before things happen. You always write your story before that itself and try to enact the story. If you don't write your story before entering into the situation, you always write the story. You'll always write, you are ready with arguments, you are ready with words, you are ready with everything even before meeting your friend. Even with your friend, you are not spontaneous. You are prepared. Now you just go with your big sheet, big paper. You go with your big, huge story book and you exactly enact. If one statement, if something goes wrong, the whole story is mess. You go with a prepared story. I tell you, if you live without prepared story, your life will become history. People who created history lived without story. Either you live with your stories and just reproduce the same stories, live and die, or you live spontaneously. When you don't write your story, others will write your story. It will become history. If you yourself constantly write your stories and enact according to that, you will be just a normal human being. You will be just normal human being. Somebody asked me, Swamiji, you are so young, already your biographies are published. More than 12 different languages. Now we have my biography. They asked me, how? This is what I told them. I never wrote my story before living. I just lived. When you just live, you do things which can never be done with a written history, with written stories. Be very clear. Whenever you prepare for future, you judge your capacity based on your past performance. But future is possibility to go beyond your past performance. Not just to reproduce your past performance. When you do not trust you can do something more than what you have done in your past, you prepare your story, go there and enact and come back, you never allow growth to happen in your being. You never allow intelligence to happen to your being. You are clear how much you can do even before entering into the future. If you see in your life, years after years you will be struggling with one problem just because you do not trust future is something more than past. In future, there is a more possibility than what you had in the past. You never trust that. You always play very safe, secured game by bringing your past again and again and again, creating a story and enacting again and again the same story into the future. I tell people in our ashram, at least do new mistakes. It's okay. But we don't even have that much of intelligence to do new mistakes. All your mistakes, if you try to analyze and put in one line, it will all be practically same thing. Maybe the quantity is little more or little less. Otherwise, the attitude and the quality will be the same. We don't have intelligence even to do new mistakes. Even to do new mistakes. Means, you are constantly carrying weight. Weight. The weight of the past. Shiva says, when on a bed or a seat, let yourself become weightless beyond mind. Bindum shikante hrutaye layante jayato layaha. He says, just be a dot which has disappeared, the small dust atom just disappeared, which doesn't exist, weightless. Damantat shobha sambhuta sukshmagni tilakakritim bindum shikante hrutaye लयान्ते ध्यायतो लयः. ब्यूटिफुल सूत्र. आई एम जस्ट ट्राइंग टू रिपीट द सूत्र सो दट लेट ऑल डायमेंशंस ऑफ दिस अफोरिज्म बी एक्सप्लेन टू यू. Even if I missed one or two dimensions, I wanted to bring it back again. I want to tell you. One more thing. Your body is matter. Your presence is energy. Your presence is purely weightless. When your presence leaves your body, the body becomes more heavy. Your body becomes heavy. Let you be clear, the presence and the weight, both are completely opposite to each other. And one more thing, this meditation can help you tremendously in the problem of obesity and overeating. You constantly eat too much, because some way you do not have your presence inside you. The matter attracts more matter, material attracts more material, weight attracts more weight. Even in the physics, mass attracts the mass. Why do you think the planet Earth has got gravity force? Mass attracts mass. If you don't have your presence in your body, you are just a mass, nothing but a mass, matter. It attracts more matter. You may fill yourself, but you won't feel fulfilled. With presence, if you eat, even with less quantity, you will feel fulfilled. Be very clear, feeling is different, feeling fulfilled is different. Feeling is totally different, feeling fulfilled is totally different. I request all of you, if any of you have obesity problem or overeating problem, means everybody, do this simple technique. Just for 5 minutes, it's not a big thing. You don't need to do this technique whole day actually. It is a very simple, very beautiful technique. Today we will practice this technique. Before eating, but before eating anything, that is the problem now. Because we don't eat once or twice a day. There is no difference between cows and us. Cows, wherever they see something which can be eaten, immediately they will open their mouth. Human beings also have become like that. No time. Even while walking and driving in this country, I saw even when they are driving, they are eating. Because that kind of food is available. And if you don't have time to eat, and then just have a Coca-Cola, that glass, that bottle, Coke bottle, you don't have to hold actually. You can use one hand and put on that steering and drive and drink. Constantly something is going into the body. Constantly the matter is attracting the matter. The material is, mass is attracting the mass. Before eating anything, try to do this meditation, but don't do it in your car. At least before morning breakfast, noon lunch and night dinner and evening snacks and between coffees and little tea and Coke in the car, burger in the bus, anywhere. I don't know what else goes inside. Oh God. And I saw the size of the food. Oh God. No, really, and let me be very clear, please understand. So much of advertisement for food should not be done. See, constantly what you see only you will feel connected. So much of advertisement for food should not be done. And you eating is somebody's business means naturally you will be made to eat. One guy goes to the psychiatrist and says, "Sir, I have too many problems." Immediately psychiatrist says, "Don't bother, everybody has got problem, even I have problem. Please sit, let's sort it out." This guy will sort it out. 3 sessions, I'll charge you $100, let's start. This guy says, 3 session $100 will solve your problems, but tell me something to solve my problem. Tell me something to solve my problem. Be very clear. So much of advertisement for food, because you eating is somebody's business. It is dangerous. It is dangerous. Constantly, without even your knowledge, without even your consciousness, so much of advertisement for the food. You start meditating on food. Eating becomes a religion. You start meditating on food. Continuously you are meditating on food. And the quantity served also. Naturally, when you buy it, what will you do? How can you waste it? I tell you, if you throw the food in the dustbin, only food will be wasted. If you dump it in your stomach, the system also will be wasted. Never feel that you are wasting food. The moment you feel enough, just throw it in the dustbin. Only food will be wasted. If you put it inside, system also will be wasted. Food you can buy, system you can't buy once more. You can't buy once more. At least before eating, just do this simple technique, very simple but powerful technique, to connect yourself again with your weightlessness. Whenever you are in ecstasy, you are in joy, you can always feel you are weightless. You are light. You always say, "I feel like flying. I feel like flying." I just saw an article. A lady in Bolivia, she is able to fly 4 feet when she is in meditation. And around the world, hundreds of these yogic flyers are showing. But of course, they are not able to fly when they are not in meditation. Only when they are in meditation, they are able to fly. Reason is, you become weightless. And whenever you become weightless, you enter into meditation. I myself have seen personally, when I was 5-year-old boy, one great yogi, Raghupati Yogi. His name is Raghupati Yogi. He lived in Thiruvannamalai, my native place, Arunachala. There, he used to teach yoga and meditation, all those things. If you see in my biography, it will be written, my first photograph at the age of 9 is taken by him only. He only took that photograph. In India, photographing is not very popular. In those days especially, 10-20 years ago and all, photography was not popular. It will be black and white photograph, because those days color photography was not available in a common way for everybody. In a big cities, one or two studios may have it, but in villages, only the black and white. That's why you will see that only black and white photograph will be there at the age of 9. And it's not common to go and have photograph and all. And it's a very rare thing, and you have to spend a lot. In those days, just for that one photograph, 100 rupees has to be spent. 100 rupees is a big money in India, and especially 20 years ago, now I am 29, when I was 9, 100 rupees is a big money. Photography means, actually, when you get married, maximum, they may take 2 photographs, before and after, AM and BM. Anyhow, and that much only, it's not a common thing. And he photographed me. And I was surprised. And it's a big fun also. You being photographed is a big thing in those days, in especially village. Village means, when I was living in my village, only 3 automobile vehicles will enter into the village per day. Whole day, only 3 vehicles will enter. Morning one bus, evening one bus, noontime one bus. If morning bus comes, we all know that we should go to the school, because the whole village is 4 street. We will run to the school. Noontime bus means we will come away from school. And usually people don't wear watches and all. Watch and clock, all those things are not common. And evening, noontime bus means we will come back from school. Evening bus means school is over. That's all we know. And the bus, that conductor also knows when he enters the village, he has to honk. Because the school person will, school teachers will know the time. That is the way schools will run. When he enters the village, he will be honking. And he has to honk because people will be playing in the road. It was, you can't think it's a road and all. Kids will be playing in the road, and not only playing, 1, 2, 3, everything will be in the road only. 1 or 2 or 3, everything will be in the road only. So he has to come and, that kind of village. And in that kind of village, photographing is too big thing. I asked him, why are you photographing? Why are you spending so much of money? 100 rupees, something like a 2-3 months, a person, if he works, he will make that 100 rupees. 2-3 months. If he makes, he will make that money. He told me, you don't know now the importance. The future will thank me just for this photograph. And he wrote that in that, behind that photograph. Still that is there in the ashram. He wrote that in that photograph, future will thank me for this expenditure. And the whole future, the humanity will celebrate this photo. I know, that is why I am taking, I am spending. And this yogi used to fly. I have seen with my own eyes, he flying. When he sits in the meditation, and he will close his eyes, and like a iron rope, the copper rope, copper wire, he will tie that copper wire in the anahata region, in the chest region, so that he can hold the breath, prana. He will tightly tight. He will just take a deep breath and tight. The moment he ties and relaxes, so much of air inside, just his body will start floating. It will levitate. Once he levitates, he will relax it. Means it's like a taking off. Then he will be there in the same space. Then after, he will remove that wire and he will be there in the same space. He will just be there. And he will just be there for hours together, like a floating in the water. He will be floating on the air. And he will tell all the small kids to go under him and come out to see whether anything is there. And we will go below him and under him and come out to see anything is there or not. And naturally, you will be shocked when you see somebody floating. It is based on this technique. It is based on this technique. When you enter into meditative state, you become weightless. When you are weightless, you enter into the meditative state. You enter into the meditative state. When you master this technique, you can start floating. Forget about floating or walking on the air. Do this meditation, at least you will walk on the planet Earth properly. We don't have to bother about floating in the air. Let's learn at least how to walk on the planet Earth properly. How to walk on the earth in a peaceful, blissful way. For that itself, this meditation can help us. You don't have to constantly think, when will I start flying? There is no need. At least learn how to walk beautifully on the planet Earth. Shiva says, just become weightless and go beyond mind. All your weight is nothing but not being aware, whether it is physical heaviness or mental heaviness. Be very clear. There are two kinds of heaviness. Physical heaviness is sickness. feeling heavy, painful, strong, irritation all over the body. This is a physical heaviness. Mental heaviness. In your mind, if you are feeling heavy, if you are feeling heavy, that's again one more weight. Give your awareness, attention to all the parts of your being wherever you feel heavy, whether it is body and mind. Give your presence, you will suddenly become weightless. When you are weightless, you will enter into the space of enlightenment. That is why not only in Vedic culture, all over the world, in all spiritual traditions, angels are always portrayed, are described as flying people. Always, all angels are described as if they are flying, as if they are flying. They are above the earth, means weightless beings, fully aware. The more you become aware, the more you become weightless. Your presence is weightlessness. If you are feeling heavy, you are absent. Wherever you are feeling heavy, physically or mentally, you are absent in that spot. If you are feeling light, weightless, you are present. Your presence is active in that spot. Understand this one key. Then we will enter into the great meditation by Shiva. Before entering into the meditation, let the sutra be clearly understood by you. Let me repeat once more. Damantachobasambhuta sukshmagnitilakakritim bindam shikante hrutaye layante dhyayato laya damantachoba sambuddha sukshmagnitilakakritim bindam shikante hrutaye layante dhyayato laya. Kids have no ego. That is why when they fall with the same pressure from the same height, if you fall, you will break your bones, you will hurt yourself. But kids won't hurt themselves. You can see in your life, the same height, same pressure, if you fall, you will hurt yourself. Kids won't hurt themselves because they have nobody to hit the planet Earth. They just fall like a flower. When a heavy thing falls on the earth, it will break itself or it will crush itself, it will damage itself. When a flower falls on the earth, neither the earth will be damaged nor the flower. Kids are like flowers. When they fall, they don't hurt themselves. Let yourself become weightless beyond mind. Actually, if you learn this simple thing, you can sit for hours together without feeling the heaviness in you. Sometime you may not physically feel, you will start mentally feeling the irritation. Without feeling the both, you will be able to sit forever, for a quite long time. You will be just weightless even after your fights. Even after your arguments, you will be just weightless. You will have so much of energy, you will be just weightless. Now, it's a beautiful sutra. But even now, I don't feel I have given the complete truth explained by this sutra, because it has got so many different meanings. Wish I could speak in Sanskrit, or wish you could understand in Sanskrit. But it is not possible. The language is not used by common man. because the language is too poetic. He says, Layante dhyayato layaha. The way in which this grammar is, these words are created, it says, when you become weightless, you go beyond mind. When you go beyond mind, you become weightless. Weightlessness is the path and the goal for going beyond the mind. So many meanings can be derived, just this one line, Layante dhyayato layaha. One more important thing, your body is made out of memories. If you are emotionally attached to some memory, if you are connected to some memory, if you are caught by some memory, that part of your body will feel heavy. Your body related to that memory, or that memory, the part of your body which is directly connected to that memory will start feeling the heaviness. You sit in your office and just remember your boss without doing any work also, you will have shoulder pain. Just for 10 minutes, can't meditate on him. You will have shoulder pain. Because the memories related to stress are awakened. Those memories are directly connected to shoulder. You will have shoulder pain. You will have shoulder pain. Constantly, when you attach yourself to some emotionally when you attach yourself to some memory, the part of the body which is related to that memory will start having pain, will start feeling heavy, will start feeling the weight. Now Shiva says, how to become weightless and how to enter into the space beyond mind, beyond memories. It's not that you will lose your memory. You will not have emotional attachment to it. You will be able to handle it in a much better way. Now, let you have a small break.